Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Dear students, assalamu alaikum and welcome back in lecture number 19. Today we are going to discuss the applications of Islamic finance. And before we go into details of this lecture, let me remind you about our previous lecture. It was about ijara, and we studied different aspects of an ijara contract. So we studied the background of an ijara contract, that what is the nature of this contract. It's simply a lease contract where the owner or the lessor can lease out its asset. And we have different applications of ijara. If we look at the Islamic financial institutions, we find different applications, and most popular one are the property financing, and we see the mode of diminishing musharaka financing in this case, and also the vehicle financing. If you go to the websites of Islamic banks, you will see car ijara, and this is the vehicle financing. And then we have project financing, personal financing, structured products according to the needs of the client. And then the definition and types of ijara, that ijara is of two types. One is that when you sell your services against a fee, it's a kind of ijara. We have engineers, tailors, doctors, all they provide certain type of services, and for those services they charge a price. It may be a kind of fee, a salary, a wage, and this is also a kind of ijara contract. And the other type is that when you lease your asset, when you sell the usufruct, the beneficial use of your asset, when you sell that, against that you charge a price. So that is again a kind of ijara contract. We have the Sharia legitimacy from sources of Quran, Hadith, and also the consensus of Sharia scholars. That in Quran we have, while describing the story of Musa alayhi salam, we heard the word hiring. So hiring is possible for the services. And also in different hadith of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, where we studied the hadith that pay the reward of the laborer before his or her sweat dries off, that is mazdoor ka paseena khushk hone se pehle uski mazdoori ada ki jaye. And also the fee must be determined in advance at the time of contract. The parties must be clear about the fee or the wages of that service. And then the leasing of agricultural land was also referred in one of hadith. So here we derive that leasing of assets is allowed in Islam, and also leasing of services is allowed in Islam. And also we have consensus of all the scholars that ijara is a valid contract and this is allowed in Islam. And then we studied different features of ijara contract, that is usufruct and services. Usufruct means the beneficial use of the asset. So if the asset is capable of providing usufruct, it means it can be rented out, it can be leased. So that can become a subject matter of an ijara contract. If there are no usufruct, then it cannot qualify as an ijara asset. And the assets for ijara, the nature of assets which qualify for an ijara contract, they are that they should have a beneficial use for some long term, for some longer period of time. Perishable goods or consumable goods, they cannot become the subject matter of an ijara contract. And likewise, the stocks of companies, I mean the shares of companies, they don't qualify as an ijara asset. And the ownership rights and liabilities, so the lessor is the owner of the asset. So lessor has leased the asset and only sold the usufruct, the beneficial use. So for that beneficial use, the lessor is charging a price that we call a rent. So if the asset is providing usufruct, it means the lessor, the owner, can charge a price, can charge the rent. And the maintenance of that asset such that the usufruct is maintained, in that case, all the expenses, all the maintenance charges, they are the responsibility of the owner. On the other hand, the lessee, which is the user of that asset, has to take care of the asset as an amana, and all the running expenses should be borne by the lessee. And the utilization of the leased asset means that the core activity that the asset is going to perform should be Sharia compliant. For example, if a transportation truck is leased for the transportation of alcoholic drinks, this contract is not valid in Sharia. And also, any machinery which is going to produce non-Sharia compliant products, leasing of that asset is also not allowed under Islamic economic system. So the utilization of the leased asset must qualify the Sharia compliance. And the lease period must be defined. It must be clear to both the parties. And the rental amount and its mode of payment. What will be the rental amount and how it will be paid? Is it going to be paid lump sum? Is it going to be paid in intervals, for example, monthly payments? And the rental amount will be determined, will be renewed after every agreed period, maybe every 2 years, every 1 year, or every time period which is agreed between the parties. And then we studied the situation of default and compensation in ijara contract. So there is a difference in understanding between the conventional economic system and Islamic financial system, that in Islamic financial system, anything outstanding, any rental which is outstanding, it means it is a debt on the lessee. So against a debt, if you want to charge any penalty, that will constitute riba. So any addition to that debt is riba, so it is not allowed. But to make sure that client will be paying the installments on time or the rental amounts on time, so a penalty can be charged. But that penalty will not be the income of the lessor. There will be a separate penalty account, and any amount which is deposited into that account will be donated to some charitable purpose. And also we studied the nature of promise in ijara arrangements. For example, at the end of the lease period, how the asset will be dealt. It may be sold to the lessee, it may be gifted to the lessee, or it may be sold to any third party. So there can be two type of promises, one from the lessor, one from the lessee. Besides the contract of ijara, a promise can be provided by the lessor that asset will be sold to the lessee. And on the vice versa, the lessor can also provide a promise that he or she will purchase the asset. So these are two types of promises, and they can be enforced through court of law. And also we studied the cancellation of ijara contract. How does it take place? It takes place when the lessee, being the user of the asset, violates the terms and conditions. Otherwise, both the parties unilaterally, they cannot quit or they cannot cancel the contract. They can only cancel the contract with their mutual consent. And after the cancellation of the contract, charges, rental charges for the remaining period will not be due from the lessee. And concept of selling of the leased assets, it's the same as we discussed in the nature of promise, that at the end of the lease period, the asset can be sold to third party or to the lessee. And during the lease period also, if the parties agree, the asset can be sold. It can be sold to the lessee or it can be sold to the third party. And then concept of takaful for ijara asset, that the owner of the asset, they want to insure the asset. They want to protect their asset against different types of damages. So being the owner of the asset, lessor has the responsibility to take different measures to protect it against different risks or damages, and the insurance expenses will be borne by the lessor. So in Islamic arrangements, so we have a substitute of insurance as takaful. So the takaful expenses will be the responsibility of the lessor. So this was the summary of our previous lecture. Now we are going to discuss the learning outcomes of our today's lecture. So after this lecture, you should be able to understand the concept of Islamic financing regarding its application in different areas like project financing. We have studied different modes of financing under Islamic economic system, and now we are going to discuss some of their applications. One is the project First of all, project financing, as it is clear, for any type of project, the financing would be required, and what will be the arrangement of that financing, what mode of partnership will be there, but is it going to be musharka, mudarba or murabha kind of arrangement? And also the working capital financing for the running businesses, suppose for the manufacturing concerns, they need raw materials, so or any working capital. So for them, the financing of raw material would take place in what mode? So we are going to discuss such things. And also in case of import financing, the Islamic financial institution will finance the expenses of import, and what is the facilities that are going to be provided to the importer. So the importer would be the client and the bank would be provider of the capital. So there can be arrangements like mudarba and musharka in these cases. And also export financing, when the client wants to export and financing is required, so in that case Islamic bank can provide financing on the basis of musharka or mudarba. So first of all, we are going to discuss the project financing. So these are the basic principles of musharka and mudarba that apply in project financing. So because the client to finance the project needs some financing, and then Islamic bank can become a partner into that venture. So this is going to be a joint venture, shirkatul aqd. So in that case, both the parties, they can enter into musharka or a mudarba contract. So these are the principles of musharka and mudarba for this particular financing. Financing in this mode of financing does not mean advancing of loan. So as it is clear, under Islamic financial system, any financing would never mean a loan. Loan is not allowed under Islamic economic system to finance any commercial activity or any asset. Only loan that is allowed under Islamic economic system is Qarz-e-Hasana, where the share of our Islamic banks in the Qarz-e-Hasana mode is 0%. Total financing of Islamic banks operating in Pakistan, their investment in Qarz-e-Hasana is 0%, as was reported by the quarterly bulletin of State Bank of Pakistan. And capital contribution or investments must qualify the requirements of musharka and mudarba. And if there are capital contributions by both the parties, the client and the bank, or the bank becoming only the rabul mal, and this is a mudarba arrangement, in both of these cases, the capital should qualify the terms and conditions as we have discussed in our lectures of musharka and mudarba. And the profit sharing ratio can be determined with mutual agreement. And like the case of musharka and mudarba, parties, they can agree on any profit sharing ratio irrespective of their capital contribution. And the sleeping partner cannot claim a share of profit more than the proportionate share in the total capital. So in this particular arrangement of project financing, Islamic Bank is not going to take part in any of the business activities of that venture. So Islamic Bank is only going to finance that activity. So in that case, it's understood that Islamic Bank is only a sleeping partner, so the share in the profits cannot exceed the total proportion of the contribution made by the Islamic Bank in the overall capital. For example, if the financing of bank is 50%, so in this case, in the total capital, bank's share is 50%, so the bank's share in profit cannot exceed 50%. It must be less than 50% or equal to 50%. If it is more than 50%, this is not a valid contract under Islamic financial system. However, losses will be shared according to the investment. Although one of the partner is a sleeping partner, and that partner cannot claim higher rate or higher proportion in the profits, but still the losses will be shared according to the capital contribution. And the traditional method of musharka or mudarba can be adopted in project financing. For example, if the financier wants to finance the whole project, the form of mudarba can take place. And if investment comes from both sides, the musharka can take place. And in case if the management is the sole responsibility of one of the partners, but the capital is contributed by both of the partners, so a combination of musharka and mudarba contracts can be applied here. So when as a manager or as the operating partner, the client signs a mudarba contract, with the capital provider, and on the other hand, since both the parties they have provided capital, so in that case they will share the profits according to the agreed ratio. Suppose the capital contribution is 50% each. In this case, the client is the operating partner, and the bank is simply a sponsor or the financier. So in this case, there will be a musharaka contract, and based upon the capital contributions, and also there will be a mudarba arrangement. For example, the client is manager as well. So being a manager, there will be a mudarba arrangement. So the profit sharing ratio might be like this, 10% and 90%. And then whatever is left, that portion of 90% can be shared according to the agreed ratio based on the musharaka arrangements. Suppose 50% each. And that 50% will be after making payment to the manager, his share or her share as a mudarib. So there will be a mudarba arrangement and musharaka arrangement. If both the partners, they invest capital, and one of the partner is manager as well. And the other arrangement is that the bank's share will be reduced because other partner is contributing as well and also providing the managerial services. So both arrangements, they are possible here. However, if the financier wants to withdraw from the musharaka while the other party wants to continue the business, what arrangements are possible then? The financier may get back the invested amount along with the profit. So at the time of withdrawal of the capital, whatever is the share of that living partner along with the profits will be the right of that living partner. And the financier can be replaced with a third party by selling the share of the living partner to a third party. Now, there are two possibilities. One of the partners or the financier, suppose the bank, wants to withdraw the capital. So in that case, that capital or that share can be sold to a third party. So it means the financier is replaced with another partner. So there will be a musharaka contract based upon the capital contribution by the remaining partners. And the other arrangement is that the share of the living partner, that is the bank, will be purchased by the client. So the client would become the sole owner in that case. So these different arrangements, they are possible. And then if there is a single transaction, suppose for a particular project financing, there is a single transaction and the client requires financing for that particular transaction. For example, the import financing and export financing. The details of these two modes we will discuss in the later part, but just some of the details of being a single transaction. So it's very comfortable for the bank and the client to finance a single transaction and determine the profits, and both will get back their capitals and the profits at the same time. For example, in case of import financing, if the letter of credit has been opened without any margin, the form of mudarba can be adopted. If the contribution comes from both partners, there will be a musharaka contract in case of import financing. If the goods are imported and the price is paid by the contribution of both client and the bank, there is a musharaka contract. But if there is no share from the client and 100% financing or the price is paid by the bank, in that case mudarba arrangement will take place. So in case of without any margin, it means without any contribution by the client, a form of mudarba will take place. And if the letter of credit is opened with some margin, it means both the partners, they contribute towards the payment of price, a musharaka or a combination of both, that is musharaka and mudarba, they can take place. Because it's a single transaction, so when the price has been paid, goods have been cleared from the port against that payment, and then those goods can be sold into the market or it can be sold to the client. and the profit thereon will be shared between the bank and the client according to the agreed proportions. And ownership of the imported goods shall remain with the financier to the extent of the ratio of investment. Suppose the price of the imported goods is 1 million, and 50% of this price has been paid by the bank. So in that case, 0.5 million is paid by the bank, and the goods worth 0.5 million, they will have the ownership of the bank. So bank will own those 50% of the goods, and the title of those goods, the title of ownership will remain with the bank. And the sale proceeds at market rate shall be divided according to ownership proportions. And the sale proceeds, if the asset is sold, and simply the profits are included there. So if the nature of the transaction is different, for example, the commodities are still with the client and the client is not able to sell those commodities, in that case the market rate will be determined, and the share of the financier will be given to him or her. And in case of export financing, goods are sold at predetermined price, and the financier can easily calculate the expected profit. So again, in this kind of single transaction, when the client has an export order, there is a buyer, there is an importer somewhere else. So in that case, the client has to arrange the goods which are going to be exported. So if the client lacks any financing, the Islamic financial institution can provide financing. So it's very simple contract. Again, the sale price of the goods is known. So the bank and the client, they will purchase the goods, and the cost of goods is known and the sale price is known. So the profits can be determined right away. And Musharaka and Mudarba both can be applied here again. If the contribution is 100% from the bank, it will be a Mudarba arrangement. Otherwise, if the contributions come from both parties, it will be a Musharaka arrangement. And the profit sharing, or the sale proceeds of those goods, will be shared according to the agreement. So any loss resulting from the negligence by the exporter will be recovered from the exporter. So there is an export order, goods have been purchased, but at that point of time, if the exporter with his or her negligence is not able to export the goods, or is not able to export it at right time, or is not able to take care of those goods, and any losses which result out of this negligence will be recovered from the client. And any loss out of natural reasons will be shared according to the proportionate capital. So any loss which is not in control of the client, or it is without any negligence or misconduct or misuse by the exporter, so in that case it's a natural loss, and it will be shared by the parties according to the proportion of investment. If this is a Mudarba arrangement, 100% capital is from the bank, so the bank has to bear all the expense, all the losses. Otherwise, according to the ratio of investment, both the parties will share the losses. Now the working capital financing. So Musharaka instrument can be used in the following way to finance a working capital requirement: capital evaluation with mutual consent, sharing in the gross profit only, and running Musharaka account on the basis of daily products. So these three arrangements are possible in case of working capital financing. So we will discuss them one by one. First of all, capital evaluation with mutual consent. In this case, the working capital is required by the running businesses. For example, any manufacturing concern or any business which is operating in the market. So for their business operations, if they need any raw materials, so in that case, under the first arrangement, that is capital evaluation with mutual consent, the contribution of both the partners will be determined. So the contribution of the bank is simple, that is any cash or monetary resources invested into the business venture, or the price of the raw materials which is paid by the bank, is the contribution of capital by the Islamic financial institution. But what will be the capital contribution by the client? So it's a running business. So for that running business, the capital evaluation will take place. What is the worth of that business? that will be the capital contribution by the client. So the capital of the running business may be evaluated with mutual consent, and it will take place with mutual consent. Both the parties should agree on the capital evaluation. And the value of the business can be treated as the investment of the person who seeks financing. So the client's share in this arrangement will be the value of the assets of that business, and the amount given by the financier can be treated as a share of his or her investment. And if musharaka is for a specific time period, so under this arrangement, if the musharaka is for a particular time period, suppose for 1 year, 6 months, for 1 month, any time period, so in that case both parties agree to share profits, and being a sleeping partner, the share of financier will not exceed his or her investment in the total proportion. So again, Islamic financial institution is only financing the transactions or the operations. So in that case, Islamic financial institution is a sleeping partner. So the financial institution's share in the profit cannot exceed the proportion of the capital provided by the financier. And at the time of expiry of the musharaka, business assets, liquid and non-liquid, are evaluated again, and profit will be distributed according to the evaluation. So in this case, the share of both the partners will be determined in the total evaluation of the assets. Suppose after 1 year or after 2 years, when it was for a specific time period, the assets will be evaluated again, liquid and non-liquid, and then accordingly they will share their contributions and also the amount of profits. So this illustration will make it more clear. We might think that at the time of contribution of the capital, if the capital contribution was 50% each and the profit sharing ratio was 30% for the bank and 70% for the client, client being the operating partner, and Islamic financial institution being a sleeping partner will have a lesser proportion of the profit. So in that case, if the assets are evaluated, so it will not be shared in the proportion of 70% and 30%. Rather, it will be shared 50% each up to the capital contribution, and any appreciation in the value of assets, that will be the profit, and it will be distributed according to the profit distribution ratio. So this example will make the concept more clear and easier to understand. Suppose the total value of the business of A, one of the part that is the client, is 30 units. 30 units, you may take it as 30 million. And B finances another 20 units. That is, B's share in the total assets is 20 units, and raising the total worth to 50 units. So in this case, A's contribution is 30 units, B's, that is the bank's contribution, goes to 20 units, totally it goes to 50 units. And 40% have been contributed by bank. So if you look at the percentage in the total contribution, it makes 40%. That is 40% of 50 units, it is 20 units. So it is contributed by the bank, and 60% by A. 60% of 50% is 30 units. So it is agreed that B shall get 20% of the actual profit. So the profit sharing proportion is 20% and 80%. Bank's total contribution in the capital is 40%, but bank's share in the profit is 20%. So at the end of the term, the total worth of the business has increased to 100 units. So at the end of that agreement, because it was for a specified time period, so at the end of that time period, the worth of asset is multiplied, it has appreciated to 100 units. So if we look at the capital contribution, it is 40% and 60%. And if we divide it with the same ratio, so the bank's share would become 40 units and 60 units for the client. So the bank's contribution was 20 units, but in this case, the after the appreciated value of the assets, bank share can go to 40 units. But this will not take place. What will happen is that the share of capital contribution will be determined or is already known, and then the appreciated value, that will constitute profit, and it will be distributed according to the ratio of distribution of the profits. So, but in order to reflect the agreed ratio of profit in the price of his share, the formula of pricing will be different. Any increase in the value of the business shall be divided between the parties in the ratio of 20% and 80%. So that increment of 50 units will be divided in the ratio of 20% and 80%, because these 50 units are the profit of the business. So in this case, ratio of distribution is 20 to 80, and B's earning would become 10 units, because 50 units have become the profit of the business. So 20% of 50 units, it's equal to 10 units. So in this case, at the end of the time period of that contract, the price of B's share would be the capital contribution plus profit thereon. So the total worth would be 30 units. And what if there is a loss? So here the situation will be different. It will be shared according to the capital contribution. So the ratio of capital contribution is 40 and 60 units, 40% and 60% by the bank and the client. And then total number of units after the loss. Suppose the initially there was 50 units, but at the end of the contract period, the assets are revalued again and its worth becomes 40 units only. So there is a loss of 10 units. So here B's share of loss would become 4 units, that is 40%, which is the capital contribution ratio, into total number of units of loss, that is 10 units of loss, so it makes 4 units. So the price of B's share would be capital contribution minus the proportionate share in the loss, so 16 units will be the share of the bank. And likewise for the client, the client's share will be reduced by 60%, so for 60% of 10 units would be 6 units. So client's contribution was 30 units minus 6 units. So the share of client in the total assets would become 24 units after this loss. Now the second arrangement in the working capital financing, first one was to evaluate the evaluation of the capital assets of the running business. The second one is sharing in the gross profit only. So while sharing in the gross profit only means that all the indirect expenses will not be deducted from the profits. Only direct expenses will be associated with the expenses of that particular venture, and the gross profits will be distributed among the partners in a certain ratio. So how it will take place, let's have a look at that. So financing on the basis of Musharaka according to the capital evaluation procedure may be difficult in a business having a large number of fixed assets, particularly in running industry, because the valuation of all the assets is not easy. So the previous model what we discussed, the evaluation of the capital of the client, so if it is a big business, so it will be difficult to value all the assets, and their depreciation or appreciation may create accounting problems giving rise to disputes. So now the depreciation of the assets of the company while valuation, it might create some confusions. So in that case, it's not easier to implement. So we can switch towards the sharing in the gross profits only, but it also has some difficulties. The major difficulties are the calculation of indirect expenses like depreciation of the machinery, salaries of the staff. So there are problems to calculate the indirect expenses proportionate to that particular venture. There might be more than one venture being operated by the client. So to allocate a particular level of expenses, proportionate expenses to each of those operations, it might be difficult. And as a solution to this problem, the parties may agree on the principle that instead of net profit, that is after deducting all the direct and indirect expenses, the gross profit will be distributed between the parties. So those indirect expenses which is difficult to associate with the operations will not be deducted from the income of that venture. So the gross profit, which is calculated only after deducting the direct expenses, and indirect expenses shall not be deducted from the distributable profits. Only direct expenses like those of raw material. So what are the direct expenses? That is raw material, direct labor, electricity, they shall be borne by the musharaka. So for this particular venture between the client and the bank for the working capital financing, so there will be direct expenses like raw material, direct labor or electricity that we can directly associate with that venture. We will deduct that expenses only, and profit share of the industrialist may be increased to compensate the use of different facilities like machinery, building and staff to that musharaka. Now we have deducted only the direct expenses, but there are indirect expenses also. There are different services being provided by the assets of the client, like the machinery of the client will be used, then the building of the client will be used, then the human resources of the client will be used. So for all these resources, for all these services, the compensation must be paid to the client. So in that case, the share of profit of the client can be increased to compensate such expenses. And the direct expenses may include the following list. The amount spent in purchasing the raw material. So the direct expenses can be the price of the raw material, then the wages of the labor directly involved in the processing of the raw material, for example, loading and unloading and transportation from here to there, and those direct expenses that can be directly associated with that particular musharaka venture, that will become the direct expenses. And the expenses for electricity consumed in processing, for example, for the processing of that particular raw material, any electricity, that is the number of units consumed of electricity, will be directly charged to such venture. And the bill for other services directly rendered by the musharaka. For example, different kind of services can be used to run that venture. So those different expenses which can directly be associated with that venture will also make part of the direct expenses. For example, a ginning factory has a building worth 22 million, plant and machinery valuing 2 million, and the staff is paid 50,000 rupees. So these are the different expenses of the running business, and the factory needs the financing of 5 million from a bank on the basis of musharaka. So by becoming partner with the bank, the client requires 5 million for 1 year. So it means that after 1 year, the musharaka will be terminated and the profit accrued up to that point will be distributed between the parties according to the agreed ratio. So, and a ratio of profit sharing will also be agreed at the time of contract. So while determining the profit, all direct expenses will be deducted from the income. Only direct expenses which can be associated with that musharaka venture will be deducted from the income, from the revenues or from the sales of that particular venture. So in this example, now the parties, they have two types of possibilities, two options, that is to pay rent for the use of building, machinery and staff of the client. Now that venture is using the building, the machinery and the staff of the client, so a rent can be paid for that. A rent will be deducted out of the revenues of that venture, or the ratio of profit for the client may be increased to compensate the use of that assets. So the all those expenses which can indirectly be associated to that venture, so those assets will be compensated in the form of rent, or the share of the profit of the client can be increased. So these are the different options available in this case. And the third option is that running musharaka account on daily basis. So the client is provided with a facility by the bank that an account is created for the client and a balance is there, and client whenever needs financing can withdraw money from that account, and whenever receives any revenues or sale proceeds or income can deposit into that account. So there will be credit and debit going on all the time. So it's a substitute for conventional banking running finance facility. Under the conventional system, financial institutions finance the working capital of the enterprise by opening a running account for them. So under the conventional arrangements, an account is opened for the client a limit is set, a line of credit is determined, and then clients draw different amounts at different intervals. For example, the limit of the client is 1 million. 1 million amount is deposited into one of the accounts, that is, it is credited against the client. And then the client keeps depositing their surplus amounts in the account. Client is going to withdraw from that account and client is going to deposit surpluses into that account. And the process of debit and credit goes on up to the date of maturity, and the interest is calculated on daily basis. So every day a balance will be determined, and for the outstanding balance for that particular day, the interest will be charged. Because client is frequently depositing and withdrawing amount into that account, so the, what is the balance? That is the outstanding amount. So the outstanding amount will be determined, so that will be kind of loan. So against that loan, every day interest will be applied and interest will be determined. So this is an arrangement which is used by the conventional system. So what facility Islamic banks provide in this case is, Islamic banks, they provide the facility of running Musharakah account on daily basis. So in this case, clients can withdraw cash as per their needs within the limit of the running Musharakah. A limit is determined, and that can be used as the contribution of the bank. Any amount outstanding will be the contribution of the bank. So there is a ceiling into for that account. For example, again, amount of 10 million. So 10 million is the limit of the client. So client might be using 6 million or 10 on any particular date. And then while the client again deposit any surplus or any sale proceeds, and it goes down to 4 million or 3 million, and again it goes to 8 million, or the outstanding balance might reach to 10 million. So these different amounts outstanding on different days is possible. And the client can deposit their collection in the running Musharakah account, and client can deposit, client can withdraw from that running Musharakah account, and clients are only required to pay profit to the bank for the net capital extended under running Musharakah facility to the client. For example, there is an account of the client with the bank. Suppose 10 million is credited to the client, and on first day the client withdraws 2 million. So in this case, for that day, the outstanding balance is 8 million. So in this case, outstanding balance is 2 million. So this 2 million is the bank's contribution towards the Musharakah contract. And the client will determine the profits on daily basis, and according to the agreed ratio, maybe according to the contribution ratio of the client, of the bank, the share of the bank will be determined on daily basis. And keeping in view the basic principles of Musharakah, the following procedure may be suggested for this purpose. A certain percentage of the actual profit must be allocated for the management. That is, first of all, out of the profits, a certain percentage, maybe 30% or 40% or any percentage, will be allocated to the management of that venture, and then the remaining profits will be allocated according to the percentage of the profits allocated to the investor. So then the percentage of profit for the investor, that is the bank, will also be determined, and the loss, if any, should be borne by the investor only in exact proportion of their respective investments. So for the loss it is clear, but for the profits, the ratio of profit after deducting the managerial expenses, then the profits will be determined on daily basis, and it will be allocated to the outstanding balance. And the bank's share will be determined on daily basis, and this will be the running Musharakah account. And the average balance of the contribution made to the Musharakah account calculated on basis of daily outstanding balances shall be treated as the share of capital of the financier. So in case of loss, the contribution of the financier will be determined by the average balance. So there are different amounts of outstanding balance. So against those all outstanding balances, an average amount will be calculated, and losses will be associated according to the, or losses will be determined according to the outstanding capital, I mean the invested capital. And the profit accruing at the end of the term shall be calculated on daily basis and shall be distributed accordingly. And third important mode application of Islamic financing is import financing. So as we have discussed in our earlier slides, this is a single transaction and it's very simple and it's quite easy for the bank and the client. Now we look into details. It's quite similar to that we already studied. So Musharka can be used for import financing as well. Types of bank charges on the letter of credit under the conventional banking system, they are the services charges under conventional banking system for the letter of credit which is being used for importing of the goods. The conventional banks, they charge service charges for opening an LC and interest charged on LCs which are not opened in full margin. So the banks, they can charge service charges and also interest on the letter of credit. And how the whole transaction takes place, let me show you the procedure. First of all, the importer and exporter, they sign a contract. So suppose an importer is based in Pakistan and exporter or the supplier is in China. So there is a contract between the importer here in Pakistan and exporter there in China for the goods related to electronics or any goods. So there is a sign, both parties, they sign a contract for supplying those goods. Now the fact is that both the parties, they are situated at different geographic locations. So in case of default, it is very difficult for any of the parties to make liable the other party. So the communication expenses, the traveling expenses, and maybe there are so many hinges and it is quite difficult. So in that case, the banks are involved, bank of the importer and bank of the exporter. So and those banks, they provide assurances and guarantees. So that letter of credit actually is a kind of surety or a guarantee to the exporter, and the procedure takes place like that. And at the second point, the importer applies for letter of credit from the issuing bank. From the client's bank, the importer will contract and will get a letter of credit. And at the third place, issuing bank, that is the bank of the importer, will contact to the bank of the exporter, that is exporter's bank or advising bank or negotiating bank. There might be certain banks which are performing such duties. They are standardized banks. LCs are delivered to them and then they contract the exporter. So when the LC has been issued to the exporter's bank, that bank then informs the exporter about the LC, that is an LC has been received. So then the exporter is sure that his receipts, they are intact. The client is not going to default. So then at the fifth step, the exporter will ship the goods. The goods will be shipped maybe in the container, and from that shipping company, the exporter will receive the documents which are normally called bill of lading. So those documents, they will be delivered to the exporter's bank. Those documents will be submitted to the bank, exporter's bank, and then exporter's bank will send these documents to the issuing bank against the payment or acceptance. So the payment or acceptance, that is the payment is made here, and those documents, they reach to the issuing bank. Now these documents, they are delivered to the So when the exporter's bank receives the payment or acceptance from the issuing bank, these payments, they are made to the exporter at the ninth step. And then in that procedure, the banks, the respective banks, they will be charging the service charges or maybe the interest amounts in case of conventional arrangements. So here, when the payment has been made to the exporter, and the issuing bank, which is now holding the documents, will release the documents against a payment from the exporter. At the 10th step, the importer will make the payment to the issuing bank, and the issuing bank will release those documents, that is bill of lading, will reach to the importer, and the importer will receive the goods by showing these documents to the shipping company. And after the importer receives the documents of import, that is bill of lading, and these documents will be presented to the shipping company, and the goods will be released and the importer can get those goods. So this is the process of letter of credit. So here in this case, Islamic banks can take the place of the issuing bank and can finance the whole transaction. So when this financing, this transaction is financed, there can be two arrangements. One is that the whole price is paid by the Islamic bank. The other one is that a part of that price is paid by the Islamic bank and part of that is paid by the client. So the part of price which is paid by the Islamic bank is the ownership of the Islamic bank into that total raw material. So for the Islamic banks, in case of import financing, collecting service charges for opening a LC is allowed. Service charges, they are allowed. And then, but the interest is not allowed. Islamic banks, they can't charge interest. So in that case, two methods are available for the Islamic banks. That is the based on Musharka and Mudarba arrangement to finance that import, and based on Murabha. That is, the Islamic financial institution appoints the client as an agent. Agent as an importer will take part into this whole transaction, and the bank will purchase those goods. Bank will purchase the assets. All the expenses will be disclosed and a profit will be added into the price, and then client will make payment later on. So both the arrangements are possible here. So under the Musharka and Mudarba arrangement, where the financing or the price is paid by the client, by the bank, maybe if it is 100%, then it's a Mudarba arrangement. If it is any percentage of the total price, then it's a Musharka arrangement. So bank and the importer, they sign an agreement of Musharka or Mudarba, depending upon the capital contribution. And if the LC is opened at zero margin, that is all the contribution comes from the bank, then a Mudarba contract will be signed. And in this case, bank will be the Rabul Mal and the importer is the Mudarib, that is the manager. And if the LC is being opened with a margin, then the Musharka agreement can be signed. So importer will purchase the bank's share at market price if goods are not sold during the specified time period. So here, when the goods have been imported and there is a Musharka or Mudarba arrangement between the bank and the client, in that case, the goods will be sold again into the market, or it will be purchased by the client if they are not sold in a specific time period. So that sale price will determine the share of profit for each of the partners. And under the Murabha arrangement, the bank will enter into different contracts with the client. So under Murabha arrangements, Islamic banks use Murabha to finance a letter of credit. The bank themselves import the required goods and then sell these goods to the importer on Murabha arrangement. So the bank becomes the owner of those goods. Bank becomes the importer on behalf of the client, and the importer promises to purchase the imported goods. And then the importer have to provide a promise that he or she will purchase those goods which are imported and financed by the bank. The bank appoints the importer as the agent of the bank. So there will be an agency agreement between the client and the bank. So the client as an agent will import the goods and also provide a promise, and then the payment mode will take place. The goods will be sold on the Murabha arrangement. And the fourth application is the export financing. It's again very simple mode. And under the conventional arrangements, banks, they perform two important roles in exports. For example, the negotiating bank, that is the bank of the exporter, as we discussed in the previous example, that is the negotiating bank or the advisory bank for the exporter, the bank which receives the LC, operates the LCs and receives the payments on behalf of the exporter. So that role can be adopted by the bank, and also financing the shipment on interest basis. And also the conventional banks, they finance the shipments based on interest expenses or the interest rates. So they have two different arrangements, pre-shipment financing and post-shipment financing. Pre-shipment financing means at the time when the exporter receives an order to export the goods, so those goods can be financed, can be purchased and the financing can be provided by the bank. But in case of post-shipment financing, what does it mean? So there is a promise by the exporter to pay the price. So the bank, so the client might have a bills receivable, an account receivable. So only document is a bill to receive the payment from the importer, maybe situated in other part of the world. So in these two cases, they are possible under the conventional system, where that document or the bill receivable can also be discounted with the bank. But under Islamic economic system, charging of interest against the financing is not allowed, and at the same time, the post-shipment document, which is a bill receivable maybe or an account receivable, for that document it cannot be discounted with the bank. So both these arrangements, they are not allowed. Islamic banks will only finance the pre-shipment financing, that is when the goods are purchased and to make them ready to export. So under this arrangement, bank and exporter can make an arrangement of mudarba when one of the partner contributes the capital, that is the bank. Otherwise, if the contribution comes from both parties, a musharka arrangement will take place, and the exporter will manufacture or purchase goods, and the profit obtained by exporting it will be distributed between them according to the predefined ratio. And in case of default by the exporter, the ultimate loser is the Islamic financial institution, because Islamic financial institution has financed the transaction maybe fully or partially. So in that case, if the exporter is not capable, or if there is a negligence on part of the exporter or a misconduct on part of the exporter, the losses can take place. Maybe the goods, they are not exported at all. So in that case, any negligence or any misconduct by the client will lead towards the recovery of those expenses from the client. And the second arrangement is the murabha arrangement. So in this arrangement, the goods which are the subject matter of the contract are purchased by the bank, and it is then sold to the client. The bank purchases goods that are to be exported at a price less than the price agreed between the exporter and the importer. So the sale price is actually the price which is negotiated between the importer and the exporter. So the bank will purchase the goods at a price, and then the sale price is that price which is settled between importer and exporter. And the two agreements are signed separately, one for the purchase of goods and the other for appointing the exporter as an agent of the bank. And the exporter then negotiate with the importer on behalf of the bank. So there is an agency agreement, and the agent would deal with the exporter on behalf of the bank. And post-shipment financing, in case of post-shipment financing, it's similar to discounting of the bill of exchange, which is not allowed under Islamic economic financial system. Because the goods have already been sold, the only thing which the client or the exporter has is a bill or a document which claims that such and such amount will be received from the exporter. And then whoever, the exporter with the bill of exchange, can appoint the bank as his agent to collect the receivable on his or her behalf. But that bill of exchange cannot be financed, it cannot be sold, or it cannot be discounted. But an Islamic bank can be appointed as an agent to collect those receipts from the exporter, just like the services of the issuing of the advisory bank or the banker of the exporter. And the bank can charge a fee for this service and can provide interest-free loan to the exporter, which is equal to the amount of the bill. So here there will be two arrangements. One is that bank will charge a fee for collection of those bills, and then at the same time bank provides a loan equal to the amount of bill. So for after particular time period, bank will be receiving that particular amount from the export, from the importer situated in other country. So the bank will earn a fee for this transaction. And exporter will give his consent to the bank that it can keep the amount received from the bill as payment of the loan. So the payment of loan will be received because it is equal to the loan amount. So the loan's amount can only be equal. There will be no up and down. Otherwise, it will constitute riba. So in today's lecture, we discussed different applications of Islamic financing in the case of project financing, then working capital financing and import financing and also export financing. Could understand the concept very well. So inshallah, we'll see you in the next lecture. Till then, assalamu alaikum.